Good evening. Today's session is a revision session that will enable you or that will help you for your upcoming examinations. As you are aware that there are four papers in your course of first year. So in today's session, we are going to cover the first two sessions, first two papers, which is general psychology and developmental psychology. So before we start with specific papers and specific questions, let us focus on a few basic things that are related to your examination. So firstly, we will talk about the papers that you have. You will be having five papers, out of which four will be theory-based papers, which will be covered in this revision sessions. So when you see the papers of your examination, you would be seeing some similarity in the question papers that you would have attempted in your bachelor's course. This is basically due to the similarity in the syllabus. Now, if you take the paper of general psychology, and for those with the who have had psychology in their first and second year of graduation, you would have had similar topics of motivation, interest, and you would also have had in your third years the topics which were related to intelligence test or personality test. And in this way, you will see there are certain similarities in your syllabus of your bachelor's and your master's course. The core difference that you would be noticing is the depth of the syllabus. When you studied the same papers for your graduation course, you must have seen that the information was much at a superficial level. The information that was given to you was in the form of an overview that helped to and help you to understand the basic concepts. However, as you are coming to your master's level, you will see that the information or the content of the syllabus is more deep. It is more towards application of these theories into your practice. So now coming to the question papers. In your question papers, you would be having three types of questions. There will be some questions which will be given a mark weightage of 5 marks. There will be some questions that will be given a mark weightage of 10 marks, and the others will be for around 20 marks. So depending on the weightage of your marks, I just got a comment which asked me to say that developmental psychology and lifespan psychology, yes, it is both included in your second paper. So I'll be covering the questions that are related to your to the lifespan psychology as well. Okay, so now we have spoken about the marks. Now we'll come to the types of questions. The first type of question that you would be asked in your examination would be direct questions. Now, these questions will have a very specific answer that you will have to give. And these questions will be based on a particular topic. So, let's say you have a topic which is related to intelligence. So, now in this, you will be asked about a specific intelligence test. Maybe you would be asked to explain what WISC is, or you would be asked to explain what Alfred Binet test of intelligence is. Now, this question is a very straightforward question. In this question, you need to give information and you will have to write as it is mentioned in the textbook. The second type of question is about comparisons. One of the examples of such a question that I had seen in previous question papers is to compare two theories of motivation. Also, another example could be comparing Atkinson's Shiffrin model of intelligence and Lockhart model of memory. The other question was to compare the Atkinson's Shiffrin model of memory and the Lockhart model of memory. So in this question, you have to, these questions basically will be for 10 marks. And these questions, you have to explain what these particular models are. And you will have to tell what is the difference between them from a theory perspective and the application perspective. So that is the second type of question that will be asked. The third type of question that will be asked to you is the application based question. Now, what is the application based question? One of the examples of, so let's start from your first papers. We'll start from papers and topics, and then we'll see what kind of questions can be asked in these papers. So the first paper that you're having is general psychology. Now, in general psychology, when you see your syllabus, there are certain topics which are very straightforward. They are related to perception. They are related to the definition and basic human nature. So in this paper, you would be asked questions related to how your brain is affecting your behavior. What are the specific parts of the brain that are related to a particular function? So let's say memory, or let's say thinking, or let's say impulse control. So in that question, you will have to mention about that particular part of the brain and how it affects through that particular function. So let's say memory, or let's say impulse control, through releasing various hormones, or through activation of certain steps. Then coming to the second topic of next topic of learning. In learning, one of the questions that has been asked very commonly is about the principles of learning. We all have studied that, you know, the first theory was of classical conditioning. The second theory that was proposed was of operant conditioning. The question papers that I had referred to was of a university which had 5 marks questions in some papers, and it did not have in some papers. So I'm not sure about the new pattern, but I'll get back to you in the next session about the new pattern of question papers. So till then, we'll focus on the questions and the topics, and in this next session that we are having tomorrow, we will see what is the new pattern, and we'll discuss that in detail, if that is okay. Okay, so now continuing from what we were talking about, when we talk about the operant conditioning, there are few principles of learning. There is principle of reinforcement. There is principle of punishment, there is principle of behavior modification, and there is principle of shaping. So till here it is all theory, and till here it is all what you had studied in your textbook. But then the next part of the question, which might ask you to implement this theory into practice. So they'll ask you, give certain instances in which you can use these principles of operant conditioning in day-to-day life or in your professional life. So here, one of the examples or one of the situations in which you can use is as a school counselor. So for example, if you are a part of an educational institution and you are working as a school counselor. So in this situation, There might be certain students who might be weak in studies, or there might be certain students who would be displaying behavior which is distracting other students, or the student himself might be distracted either due to a psychological condition or either due to a social condition. So in this situation, as a school counselor, how will you use the principles of conditioning or the principles of operant learning to help the child improve in his educational process or educational tests. So what you can do is you can use the principle of reinforcement. Now, reinforcement in the sense, a child, let's assume that there's a child X, and that child is having certain problems in his or her family, due to which the child is not able to focus in school. The child is a very brilliant child, and the child is, you know that the child has the ability to give his exams, to focus on his classroom, and to deliver results in his educational career. But because the child is having difficulties in his house, the child is not able to focus. The child is distracted. The child is not motivated to study or to pay attention to the teacher. So when you're working with this particular child in this situation, when you use the principle of, let's say, we started reinforcement. So you, every time that you, every, so you, you also include the teacher in this process. And every time you see that the child has, you know, participated in the classroom, maybe by listening attentively, or by also asking questions in the classroom, or by completing his or her homework. So you ask the teacher to reinforce or to praise the child either in an individual setting or in the classroom setting. That will help the child to pay attention in the classroom. The second thing that you can also do is whenever you see a child outside the classroom situation and you see that the child is not engaging in disruptive behaviors, you can also praise the child. You can also say something that is positive, something that is motivating to the child. Depending on the child's age, you can also incorporate charts, or you can also incorporate principles of shaping, which means that every time a child reaches a certain level, the child will be given a token. And then if he collects a certain number of tokens, then the child will be given what he would have desired at the starting of plan. So that is a principle of shaping. You can also use principle of behavior modification. So what you do is, let's say the child is engaging in physical fights. So you directly will have to, so what you do, you break the behavior. So you break the behavior in small levels. You say that the child will not use abusive language. The child will not get easily provoked by the classmates, or the child will not use physical abuse, or the child will not retaliate to physical abuse. So in this stages, you can incorporate, you can see, if you see the differences in his behavior, and if you see that the child is not reacting, or the child is not retaliating, or the child is fulfilling his desired objectives, then you start giving him tokens. You start giving the child points or whatever tokens you decide in the initial of the in the beginning of the plan. So this is the plan that you have developed to deal with, to help the child in the counseling process. And in this, you have used these principles of conditioning. So this is the kind of question that you will get in your examinations. So this is one kind of question that you will see. Then the second kind of question that we were talking about were comparing two concepts. So let's say if there is a question that is asked to you that compare, or what is the difference between paper pencil tests and performance tests, and what are the settings or what are the applications of a paper pencil test vis-a-vis a performance test of intelligence. So coming to the application part of intelligence tests, we all know that intelligence tests are basically used for school going children, that is between the age of 3 years to 16 years. And we might use it till 18 years, but in most of the cases, we use only till 16 years. And when we talk about these two categories of intelligence tests, that is paper pencil tests and performance based tests, we are aware of the certain stark differences that we see in these tests. So when you're comparing these tests, firstly, it is important that you give a small introduction as to what these tests are about. So you can give some examples of a paper pencil test, it could be the Binet-Simon test, it could be the WISC, it could be the WAIS, or and also you can give certain examples of a performance-based test. It could be Wechsler's performance test. It could be Collinson Drever's performance test, and then you can explain what these performance tests aim at. Okay, so and then you can either in a tabular form or either in a paragraph form, you can explain what are the differences between these two tests. So let us discuss some of the differences between the ink and the paper pencil tests and the performance tests. The first difference is that the paper pencil perform tests can be conducted in a group, but the performance test has to be conducted individually. The second difference is in terms of the way in which the examination is conducted. Here in the paper pencil test, you have to so application in your daily life, see what happens is that mostly you will have to take a situation in your day-to-day life. So, but here the situation is not important. When you're writing this examination, the situation you will have to think by yourself, but the examiner is not interested in the situation. The examiner is interested in the theory that you are using in the situation. So for example, when we spoke about operant conditioning, we mentioned that this particular principle will be used in this particular situation. So we said that we will use reinforcement here. And then you can also mention that, you know, we will use either fixed schedule of reinforcement, because in the initial stages we will use fixed schedule because the child is new to reinforcing. The family has never reinforced the child, and therefore we are using fixed schedule and with a smaller interval. So the interval between the two periods of reinforcement is very short, and as the period passes on, the child is more used to getting reinforced, we will increase the duration between the two reinforcements, so the child is not dependent on the reinforcement alone. So in this scenario, the examiner is not interested in the case. The examiner is interested in what theory you are applying and how are you applying that theory. So as you see in developmental psychology also, you will be asked a lot of questions based on situation. Here, they will not give you a situation. So they will give you a situation, but not exact situation. So let's say I'm asking you a question that how will you use an interest test as a career counselor? So in this, to help you answer the question, you can write that there is a situation, and in this situation, I'll use this theory. So in application-based question, the aim to write the situation is to help you write the answer. Because if you just write vague theories, the examiner will not know how are you going to apply the theory. If you are giving a particular situation, then the examiner will know that you have understood the theory and you are using the theory in the right direction. Okay, so I hope that answers your question. And when we talk about developmental psychology, we'll talk about specific daily life situations, and these life situations can be very simple. You don't need to elaborate the situation. So I'll come to an example in the next paper when we're talking about developmental psychology and lifespan psychology, as to how you can just explain the situation in one sentence, and then you can write about the theory and explain how you are going to use it. Okay, so we are talking about the performance tests, and we were talking about the what is the difference in the application? So you must have seen in today's schools, you must have seen that there are many schools that take examinations for toddlers. In big schools or in international schools, you see that when a child wants to enter the school, or when the parents want the child to for an admission, they ask the child certain basic questions, but they ask the child to do certain things. For example, in one of the schools, they ask the child to go to the next room and get few things, or
they ask the child to get a specific color object. They ask the child to get a yellow color square block. So that is the application of a performance-based test. What is happening in these, in nowadays is in schools, they want to know if the child can understand instructions. They are not interested in knowing if the child can do a maths problem or the child can read well. They are interested obviously in these things, but their main focus is in understanding that is the child listening to small instructions. Sometimes what happens is children, because their attention span is so small, they are not able to pay attention to minute details. So for example, if you ask a child to get a yellow color square toy, the child might either listen to yellow or the child might either listen to square. And then the examiner or the person who is in charge of admission wants to know if the child can listen to both, like child is properly listening to that statement. The child is grasping that information and then he or she is following that instruction. So in that case, performance tests is important. Performance tests are also used in cases where there are children either with the, they are either mentally challenged, they are having mental retardation, or they are children who are having language deficiencies. In that case also, personality tests is used. Whereas in the paper pencil test is basically used in the continuous assessment progress. So a paper pencil test is used when the school has taught or given some information, imparted some knowledge to the child, and then they want to know if the child is grasping. So if you see a child who has come to you, and if you see that child is weak in a particular subject, let's say either maths or English, in that case you use a paper pencil test and not a performance test. So that is the difference in application of these two tests. Okay, so this was the second type of question that would be asked to you. So in this manner, there will be different types of questions that will be asked to you. So the examiner will be interested in knowing that are you using the appropriate theory at an appropriate application stage? Okay, so now let's talk about the second paper. The second paper is developmental psychology. Now in developmental psychology or developmental psychology and lifespan psychology, the most of the questions will be very straightforward. They might either ask you about So when you see developmental psychology, when you see the syllabus of developmental psychology, it is mainly divided into the process of development. So that is either explained by Eric Erikson's theory of developmental stages or the various aspects of development, the physical development, emotional development, cognitive development, social development. Then you also have thinking and reasoning or linguistic development. So these aspects of are given in detail at every stages. So you might be asked questions. Okay, so we must present the textual answer, and at last we must give a thorough example. Or 1 second. So just 1 minute. Present the textual answer. You can do both ways. Like if the question is divided into two parts, then you have to do like you have said. You have to present the theory first and then you have to give your example, or then you have to give the explanation of how you are using the theory. But if there's only one question that, how will you use interest tests in counseling, or what is the implementation of SVIB, that is an interest test for you as a career counselor. So in this you will have to give it in between. So you cannot just because the question, so it depends on how the question is formatted, because if there are two questions, then each question will have an equal weightage of marks. So in that case it will be easier for you to write it in the form of the textual answer and then the example, But if the question is directly an application based question, then you can start with the example also. So the way you format the question totally depends on the format of the question, and also depends on your style of answering. Okay. Talking about developmental psychology, in this there'll be questions that will be asked to you in a straightforward manner. So what is the cognitive changes that a child will experience when during the early childhood stage? So that is one question that could be asked. Another question could be asked is that what are the emotional development, or what are the physiological changes that a person experiences during middle adulthood, or during adolescence, or during preteen? So these are the questions that will be asked about a specific area of development, then in a particular stage. So that is a very straightforward answer. Another question that is asked commonly is, what are the factors that influence prenatal development in a child? So that here also, there's a lot of, so when you speak about developmental psychology, there's a lot of theory, but that theory is also impacted by the present scenario in which we are living. Now, I'll give you a small example. The question that I was talking about, that what are the factors that influence the prenatal development of a child? So obviously there is genetic factors, there are chromosomal factors, there are biological factors that are involved in the process of prenatal development of a child. But there are also psychosocial factors that are a part of the child, prenatal environment of the child. They could be in the form of medicines, they could be in the form of social drinking, because they could be in the form of a social environment. They could also be in the form of the family of the child. One of the examples that comes to my mind in this is, these days, like not earlier, it was not very common in India, but these days prenatal counseling is very, very common. You know, parents who are undergoing, or if a lady is expecting a child, the doctors, the family, the friends, all of them, they give some they encourage the couple to go for this joint counseling sessions. So now, does that have an impact on the prenatal development of the child? We also have these different groups that, you know, they talk about music, they talk about positive thoughts, they talk about reading during the prenatal span of a childbirth. Now, all these things were not very common maybe in a generation prior to us, or maybe even 10 years prior to us. But these days, these things are very common. So when a question like this is asked, you can use your understanding, you can use your knowledge of the current events that are happening around you, and you can also mention them in your answer, because you don't need to limit your answers just to the theory that you have studied in your in your syllabus, that, you know, in the textbook that they are given, that there are five factors. So it is genetics, it is medicines, it is chromosomes, then the diet of the mother, or the psychosocial environment. So you can mention them also, but then you can also mention according to your understanding and according to what you're seeing around you, that, you know, don't you think that these also will be impacting the development of the child. Another factor that is also important and that we need to consider, I'm not sure if that they have mentioned in the syllabus, but then whether the child was a planned pregnancy or an unplanned pregnancy is also important when we kind of, you know, talk about the prenatal development of the child, because that will kind of impact the emotional health of the mother, and that will also have an impact on the child. Social drinking is also one of the factors that can influence the prenatal development. So what happens is most of the times, because it is culturally accepted or socially accepted or it is a fashion, even women frequently consume alcohol. And a lady might not be aware that, you know, she is in the first month of her pregnancy, because by the time you know it, you must have either crossed a couple of weeks to, you know, confirm that you have had a positive pregnancy report. Hence, there might be a possibility that the mother must have consumed alcohol. And we all know that, you know, in the cases when the consumption of alcohol by the pregnant lady can be very harmful for the child. And if the mother is aware of this, and if she becomes, if she starts panicking, so what do you do in that situation? Because that is also that will also impact the development or the prenatal development of the child. And how much it will impact, that will depend on what stage it was, or what amount of alcohol was consumed, how frequently, when it was stopped. So there are complications that are seen because of the changing scenario around us. Okay, so I have a query which says, okay, so I have a question paper, just a second. In this question, the total strength of the question paper is 80 marks. In this, there are two questions of 20 marks each. Then there are two questions of 10-10 marks each. So 20-20-40. Then 20 marks, then 10-10, so 20. So 20-20, 10-10, and then there are four short notes that have to be written for 5 marks each. So there are two questions for 20 marks each, there are two questions for 10 marks each, and there are four short notes for 5 marks each. Okay, another question that will be asked to you is, what is the significance of counseling at pre-retirement stage, or what is the significance of counseling for premarital counseling, or what is the significance of career counseling, or what is the significance of sex education? So these questions will also be asked during the examination. Now here, we all know that every stage, there are certain developments that are happening in an individual. So these developments are physical, they are cognitive, they are emotional, they are social, there are developments in your thinking and reasoning, there are spiritual development. So these questions are related to these areas that you are getting developed, that you are experiencing changes. And also the situation and the surrounding around you that is changing continuously. So here what you can do is you can use any theory. So I am using Eric Erickson's theory, because Eric Erickson has kind of, you know, a simplified human life to some extent by saying that every stage you have to achieve something to easily go on to the next stage. And if you cannot, you know, if you are not able, okay, I'm sorry, I'm really not aware about the hall tickets and centers. If in case I have any information by tomorrow, I will surely let you know. I will try and get some information, but I'm not really sure about it. I'll get to you in case I have some information. Okay? Okay, so I'm taking this theory because it goes on through lifespan. Now, there's also a theory that was given by Freud, but that is not covering the entire lifespan of an individual till retirement or, you know, old age. And hence, I'm not taking that theory, and I'm taking Eric Erickson's theory. So let's say that the question is, what is the importance of premarital counseling? So now, let's imagine that, you know, a couple will come to you for premarital counseling between the ages of 18 to 35, because if we take the current scenario, the what do you say? The age at which people are getting married is by, you know, it is not like earlier that people used to get married by the age of 23 or 24. But now people are waiting till 35 or even 40 sometimes to get married. But for writing, for the answering purposes, let us keep it restricted to 18 to 35 years of age. So now before 18 years, what are the various stages that a person has already crossed? It is trust versus mistrust. It is anatomy versus shame. It is initiative versus guilt. It is industry versus competency. It is identity versus role confusion. Intimacy versus isolation. Right? So these are the stages that a person might have, you know, either covered or either might be in that particular stage. So when you are counseling a couple for a premarital counseling, you would be counseling them individually and you would be counseling them as a couple. So when you are speaking to them as a couple, obviously you will speak to them about their expectations from each other, the expectations from themselves, the expectations from the relationship, and whether they match or no, and how much they are willing to contribute towards that relationship. So that those are the certain things that you would be asking. Now, another thing that you would be focusing when you are speaking to them together is their family backgrounds. What kind of family background they come from, what kind of values they have, belief systems they have, are there any clashes between the belief systems of the families? So those are the topics that you would be covering when you are talking to them together. When you are speaking to them individually, you might want to ask them, is there something that they are not comfortable speaking to the partner? So you might want to talk about their early child experiences. See, mainly because let's say there is a boy or a girl, and that particular person does not have very good relationships with their parents, or either they have a history of abuse. It could be physical abuse, emotional abuse, neglect. It could also be sexual abuse. And that particular person is coming to you. And this history is not revealed to the other part. So before, because of this history, the earlier stages of development might not have been covered. And that can pose a threat to the coming relationship. Therefore, it is important that you take the history of the couple as individuals. You also take the history of relationships if they have had before, because we talk about intimacy and isolation. And if the person is not happy or is not, it wants to be isolated and not in a relationship, then there could be concerns when it comes to the relationship or when they get committed. You also need to speak about the medical history. Medical history is important because there are certain diseases that might be communicable. There could be cases of thalassemia, there could be cases of STDs, there could also be cases of psychiatric history wherein that person was maybe treated for depression, anxiety, or a certain phobia, or it could also be a very high, it could be a pathological disorder. Maybe the person might have any pathological disorder, we are not aware. But then that history needs to be collected individually. And then you need to say that, you know, if there is something that has to be conveyed to the other party, then how it has to be conveyed. So all these things need to be covered in premarital counseling. Now how it gets related to Erik Erikson's theory? We spoke about trust and mistrust. Now coming to autonomy and shame. So if let's say that the wife or the lady, she wants to manage the house, she wants to become a homemaker, and the groom or the man feels that, you know, he would be shameful if his wife is a homemaker. He wanted to marry somebody who is a career woman. So here, that will show what kind of, you know, then how do you come to a conclusion? How do you come to a joint, this thing that, you know, to a middle path, saying that this is how it is going to happen and how these two parties are going to accept it? You also need to talk about the process of marriage. It could be like I had spoken earlier that, you know, the it could also be about values, systems, then what will happen after marriage, childbirth, responsibilities, sharing of responsibilities. So all these three things need to be covered in pre-marital counseling. Okay, you will not be asked 8 questions. You will, so the first question, like this question pattern that I had seen. So question number 1 was answer any one out of 2 for 20 marks. Question number 2 was also any one out of 2 for 20 marks. Then question number 3 was any 2 out of 4 for 10 marks. So there were around 3 to 4 questions. And you had to answer any 2. And for short notes, there were 6 short notes and you had to attempt 4. So question number 1 was any 1 out of 2. Question number 2 was also any 1 out of 2. Question number 3, that was for 10 marks. And that was any 2 out of 3 or 4 in different papers. Then the last question was question number 4, that is short notes. There were 6 questions and you had to attempt 4. Okay, so the session I think will end in a couple of minutes. Thank you for being a part of this session. I will check about your question papers. I'm not sure if they will give me information about the hall tickets, but if they give me, I will share with you. But about the question paper patterns, I'll surely check and I'll get back to you. Okay, so tomorrow we are going to talk about the next two papers. The third paper, that is personality. And the fourth paper, that is social psychology. In case you have any specific question that you want me, that you know you want to ask how to answer that question in the papers that we had discussed today, you can mention it in the comments, and the papers for today will cover in the last 10 minutes tomorrow. Okay. Also tomorrow I'll let you know about the question paper pattern. So thank you very much, and I hope the session was helpful. Passing mark generally in most of the papers is 35, but I'll get back to you in that case also. Okay, so it is 35% basically, that is passing marks.